Muy buenos días a todos. Llegamos al último día del 16º Congreso La Investigación, Retos Actuales en la Investigación, la Innovación y la Educación en Colombia. Ayer el profesor Óscar Franco nos habló desde el punto de vista epidemiológico sobre una situación que nos afecta a todos en su conferencia que tituló Desde la prevención cardiovascular hacia el envejecimiento saludable, mi travesía científica. También continuamos escuchando varias experiencias de investigación e innovación en los simposios. Hoy tendremos la posibilidad de escuchar los siguientes: investigación básica y teórica, resultados de investigación e innovación sobre COVID-19, desigualdad, inequidad e inclusión, y dos nuevos que son justicia, construcción de paz y conflicto en Colombia y una agenda científica para un mundo cambiante. Les recuerdo que este año el Congreso se ha enfocado en trabajar los retos actuales en la investigación, la innovación y la educación en Colombia. Hoy nos acompaña el tercer y último conferencista y estará con nosotros hasta las antecitos de las 10 de la mañana. Y luego las salas, desde las 10, se dividirán en cuatro para que continúen escuchando y preguntando sobre los temas de su preferencia. Pueden consultar el programa en www.javeriana.edu.co/congreso. Tendremos, por supuesto, y como en los días anteriores, un espacio para preguntas después de esta conferencia magistral de la mañana, de tal manera que pueden enviarlas por medio del chat de la plataforma o en la red social en la que está viendo la conferencia. Bueno, pues sin más, doy paso al vicerrector de investigación de la Pontificia Universidad Javeriana, Luis Miguel Rengifo, para presentar a nuestro tercer conferencista, el informático y experto en Big Data, el danés Torben Bach Pedersen. Buenos días, Luis Miguel.
Muy buenos días, Lisbeth. Muy buenos días a todos y a todas. De manera especial, quiero agradecer a nuestro conferencista por haber aceptado estar hoy con nosotros. Y antes de darle la palabra, quisiera presentarlo ante ustedes. El doctor Torben Bach Pedersen es profesor de informática en la Universidad de Aalborg, Dinamarca. Sus intereses de investigación incluyen la analítica de datos a escala extrema, los almacenes de datos, los lagos de datos, la analítica predictiva y prescriptiva, centrándose en tecnologías para grandes datos multidimensionales, la integración y el análisis de grandes cantidades de datos multidimensionales complejos y altamente dinámicos. Su principal ámbito de aplicación es la energía digital, donde se centra en la flexibilidad energética y el análisis de series temporales de energía a escala extrema. Ha publicado más de 300 artículos en revistas indexadas, ha recibido más de 7.200 CITES y tiene un índice H de 49. Es un científico distinguido de la Association for Computing Machinery y miembro de la Academia Danesa de Ciencias Técnicas y de la Computación. Symposium on Spatial and Temporal Databases ha sido editor del área del Institute of Electrical and Electronic Engineers Transactions sobre Big Data, Information Systems y del Springer Engineering Data Bank System. Y es invitado tradicional en las mayores conferencias relativas a las bases de datos, entre ellas Special Interest Group on Management of Data, la International Conference of Data Engineering y la International Conference on Extending Database Technology, entre otras. Recibió el premio a la mejor ponencia de la Association for Computing Machinery con eEnergy en el 2017 y recibió un doctorado honorífico de la Universidad de Dresde, Alemania, en el 2020, por su trabajo sobre la gestión de flexibilidad energética mediante FlexOffers, que se utiliza en más de una docena de proyectos de investigaciones internacionales y nacionales en Dinamarca, con más de prosumidores y más de 7 productos comerciales. Es cofundador de las empresas derivadas PlaceShape y Modern Data. El título de su conferencia magistral es Una agenda de ciencia de datos para un mundo cambiante. Bienvenido, doctor Pedersen.
Professor Torben Bach Pedersen from the Center for Data Intensive Systems at Computer Science at Aalborg University, Denmark. And I'm going to talk about a data science agenda for a changing world. Thanks a lot for inviting me to give this keynote. So who am I? Well, in the beginning of my career, I spent a lot of time trying to put the world into cubes. We'll see later what they are. And later in my career, I have also focused a lot on extracting value from data. What are we going to talk about today? Well, the world is changing, as the theme of your conference says. But how is it changing and what can we do about it? And what should we work on as researchers? Here I'll introduce the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. I will also talk about how scientific paradigms have evolved from the early days of science until today. Then I'm coming to the main topic of my talk, which is data science, a new skill for all researchers. First, I'm going to look at the foundations, which are business intelligence and big data. I'm going to look at data science processes and tools, and then I'm going to look at the case of data science for a specific domain, namely digital energy, which is my main application area. However, the idea of this talk is that you should relate data science to your research area. And this is not just if you're a scientist or an engineer. Also, this is relevant for digital humanities and computational social science. Then I'll round off with an outlook, and I can give a sneak peek already here. We will all become part-time data scientists. So stay tuned. So the world is changing. It's changing in bad ways. We have the COVID-19 pandemic, we have climate change, and so on. But it's also changing in good ways. Life expectancy is generally increasing, literacy is increasing, and so on. As researchers, we're fortunate enough that we can often choose our own topics, so we should work on things that matter. But with so many problems, how do we know what's important and what is not? Well, luckily, someone else did the thinking for us, namely the United Nations. The United Nations proposed in 2015 the Sustainable Development Goals, which were adopted by all member states for the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. There is a lot of wide range of goals. No poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice, and strong institutions, and perhaps most importantly, partnerships for the goals. No one can do this alone. So really, there's a wide range of options for you to help improve the world. So please have a look at the SDGs. So, but how do we get started on this? Of course, no one can work on all of these things at once. So what you should do if you're interested in sustainable development is that you could pick one or most a few of these that you can contribute to. These should be SDGs that inspires you as a person, that fit well with your research area, and where you already have a network and relevant resources so you can start making impact. Remember number 17 again, partnerships for the SDGs. So working in interdisciplinary partnerships will give more impact and will be more fun for you as well. So I will later in the talk show what is my case. I have been working a lot on SDG 7 and 13. But first, let's talk about something which is a common tool for all of us, namely data. So first, we need to talk about the scientific paradigms. So all sciences are now developing. So if we look back in history, we'll see that the first kind of science was empirical science. So you did experiments, you tried to burn something, see what happened. That was an early chemistry experiment. The apple fell down from the tree on Newton's head and so on. That was an early physics experiment and so on. So this was lasted until perhaps around 1600. Then increasingly theoretical science was developed. So Newton himself was one of the early people to do that. So developing mathematical models for the physical laws, for mechanics, thermodynamics, and so on. So these are the formula and the equations you see here. And of course, the point of this is that these two paradigms, they work well together because the experiments can inspire the theory and the theory can sort of help make sense of the experiments. Okay, so, and then things were stable for a few hundred years. And then what happened was that increasingly in the, not so many years ago, we got a new tool. So basically some things are very hard to experiment on a large scale, but instead we got very powerful computers. So especially scientists like chemists and physicists and so on, they started doing simulations. So they had models of small things like atoms and molecules and so on. And then they did very large scale simulations to see, okay, so what happens when you actually apply these laws at a large scale, and the simulations gave new insight. And again, they enriched the previous two paradigms. Now this is already happening again. So there's a new fourth paradigm about big data driven science. So this is about, you have lots and lots of sensor data, you apply AI, statistical learning, data mining, pattern and anomaly detection and so on, and use this again to drive science forward. So this is now a fourth scientific paradigm. The examples you see here are from natural sciences, medicine, and engineering, but remember, this is also relevant for humanities and social sciences. So the fourth paradigm, this term was coined by the late Turing Award winner, Jim Gray, and detailed in this 2009 book by his colleagues from Microsoft. The idea is that the emerging availability of very large data sets about most phenomena in the physical world will change all sciences and give birth to the new discipline of data science. So, what is data science? Well, certainly there's a lot of talk about all this data that is available, big data and so on. So here are some cover pages, one from The Economist about data sort of raining down on our heads, and one from Wired, which sort of talks about actually this fourth paradigm. Does that mean the end of science? Don't we have to sort of develop theories anymore? Can the computer just figure out everything from data? Probably not, but it's certainly a good headline. So let's look at what data science is. What can we do with data? So if we have data and we have models, so these are models are sort of the descriptions, theories about that data, then we can predict. And let's take an example that most of us know well. So American elections, US elections. So you remember probably Nate Silver, who made his name famous by using math to, in 2008, he could call 49 out of 50 states in the 2008 election correctly. And in 2012, he could call all 50 of them correctly before the election, that is. Okay, so this was all good. So we can, if we have data and we have models, we can do predictions. But of course, then the model needs to know the rules. And here Nate Silver explains what the rules are. So, well, this is very simple. Obama is leading in the polls in Ohio, and he's leading in other states, and that's enough to get him to 270 electoral votes. Again, it's even simpler. Obama's ahead in Ohio, so he will have enough. And then, of course, in 2012, this worked fine. So the bar set by the competition was low. So you could look like a genius by simply doing some fairly basic research into what really has predictive power in a political campaign. So here Nate Silver explained, you know, this is probably pretty easy to predict how is the US election going. However, you know, then the problem with models is that they should generalize to new data. So what happened in 2016? Well, first of all, here we have some data sort of, you know, from back from 2015. And here's actually exactly Nate Silver's website, 538, explaining why Donald Trump isn't a real candidate in one chart, which is basically because Trump is sort of an outlier that has very high name recognition, but low ratings. So he's not a real candidate. Okay, we know how things went. Let's see. And then, of course, as we all know, in 2016, Donald Trump got elected. He won the election. And how could Nate Silver miss that? Well, Nate Silver said Trump has no chance. Hillary is going to win. He was wrong. So where did he go wrong? And of course, the problem is that Silver's system, it depended largely on poll numbers. And what if the polls were basically wrong? So the input to the model was wrong data. So if you put garbage into the model, you get garbage out. So this is not so easy, but let's have an exercise for you. So it's sort of an experiment. I'll walk you through it, but it sort of shows the kind of thinking you have to go through to do data science. So the hypothesis is that parents believe more often that their sons are gifted, so high intelligence, than their daughters. It's not to say that the sons are more intelligent. It's just the hypothesis that this is what the parents believe. And another hypothesis is that parents care more about the appearance of their daughters than about their sons. So these are two hypotheses that we have, and we want to test them. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, perhaps we'll use Google. But of course, we can't sort of search that directly on Google. But what Google has is this very interesting tool called Google Trends, where basically you can sort of analyze the search queries that people do on Google, and then you can find out how frequent they are and so on. So if we look at the results for Google Trends, then for every 10 US Google queries about boys being overweight, there are 17 queries about girls. Okay, so it looks like perhaps there's a bit more searches on girls being overweight, whereas in reality, the boys are actually more likely to be overweight. And then if we look at the queries, is my daughter gifted? Every time there's 10 such queries, then there are 25 queries saying, is my son gifted? Actually, the girls are more likely to be in a gifted education program. So this looks convincing, right? So if you look at the queries here, you know, is my son, daughter a genius, intelligent, stupid, behind a leader, and so on. This is more to the boy side, and depressed, beautiful, ugly, more to the girl side. This looks very convincing. It looks like we might have a point here. However, if you actually dig down to it, you can see that these queries are sort of actually quite rare, and they sort of, you know, things go up and down over time. So here, the son gifted is sometimes below the daughter gifted, and so on. And these are actually extremely rare, right? So many, some years, not much is even happening. So actually what we did was we overinterpreted on data, on too little data. So this is the risk of doing data science. Okay, so this is not so easy. So what can we do? Well, okay, this is what the discipline of data science is all about. So let me go back and have a look at some historical use of the term. So data science was, as a term, was first introduced actually by a Danish computer scientist, Turing Award winner Peter Naur, who won the Turing Award for Algol 60 in 1960, and he used it as a substitute for computer science. And as a funny fact, the Danish term for computer science is these days datalogi. So it's a focus on data, on the data rather than the compute. And if we look at Wikipedia's explanation of this, Naur really disliked the term computer science And he suggested it was instead called datalogy or data science. And actually the former term datalogy has been adopted in Denmark and in Sweden using an I instead, while the latter is now used for data analysis, so including statistics and databases. So this is how it sometimes goes. Okay, so data science, the term emerged 60 years ago, but now it's sort of been reinvented. And how is the situation today? So we have the right that today we can hope for low-cost hardware and software environment for data analysis. We have a high-speed network. We can do intensive analysis of very large databases. Computer scientists have attempted to fill the void, but the knowledge among computer scientists about how to think of and approach the analysis of data is limited, just as the knowledge of computing environments by statisticians is limited. So a merger of the knowledge bases would produce a powerful force for innovation. This suggests that students in data science should have the opportunity to pursue courses in computer systems and in the mathematics of computing. So this is a very foresighting article by Cleveland, who in 2001 publishes the article Data Science, an Action Plan for Expanding the Technical Areas of the Field of Statistics. So he's a statistician, but then he says, we actually need to learn more about this computer science stuff. So what is data science then? Well, if we look at Wikipedia, we can see that data science, also known as data-driven science, it's an interdisciplinary field about scientific methods, processes, and systems to extract, to extract knowledge or insights from data in various forms, either structured or unstructured. Data science is a concept to unify statistics, data analysis, and their related methods in order to understand and analyze actual phenomena with data. It employs techniques and theories drawn from many fields within mathematics, statistics, information science, and computer science, and in particular from the subdomains of machine learning, classification, cluster analysis, data mining, databases, and visualization. And as we heard Turing Award winner Jim Gray imagine data science as a fourth paradigm of science, complementing empirical, theoretical computation and now data-driven science. And he asserted that everything about science is changing because of the impact of information technology and the data deluge. So what is data science? Well, actually data science sits at the intersection of three things. So as we already heard, it sort of sets that we have something from mathematics and we have something from computer science. And then if we look at sort of the intersection of mathematics and computer science, that is what we can call machine learning, sort of the core technique in AI. But then very importantly is also domain expertise. So you can't do this in a void. You need to know something about the domain you are working on and the data that comes out of it. So domain expertise is the third thing. And again, the intersection of mathematics and domain expertise is what we know as statistics. And domain expertise and computer science is data processing. But only when all three of them come together, we really have data science, which is sort of the core of the intersection of these three disciplines. So what is a data scientist? Again, Wikipedia. So data scientists use their data and analytical ability to find and interpret rich data sources. They manage large amounts of data. Despite hardware, software, and bandwidth constraints, they merge data sources. They ensure the consistency of their data sets, create visualizations to aid in understanding data, build mathematical models to use the data, and present and communicate their facts. So they also tell about what they learned. They are often expected to produce answers in days rather than months, work by exploratory analysis and rapid iteration, and to produce and present results with dashboards rather than paper reports, as statisticians do. Data science is not only about technology and math. Effective data science require a combination of technical skills and soft skills to turn data into actionable insight. Okay, so that's a really long definition here. But if we look at the data scientist, and also data scientists have been called the sexiest job of the 21st century, it's really a mix. So basically, we have four kinds of skills here. So we have math and statistics, you know, machine learning, statistical model experiments, inference, blah, 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 blah. So this is sort of, we have programming, basic computer science. You can program in Python. Perhaps you can use a statistics package like R. You can handle databases with SQL and NoSQL databases and the relational algebra. You can scale this to really big parallel databases. You can perhaps use big data tools like MapReduce, Hadoop, and Hive, these days Spark, and some custom things. And you also can perhaps use some cloud services. Then these are sort of hard skills, right? But then also you have domain knowledge and soft skills. So you're really passionate about your domain and business. You're curious about data. You can influence, but without authority. You have a high hacker mindset. You're a problem solver, and you're sort of strategic and proactive and collaborative and so on. And then also you have the fourth one, which is about communication and visualization. So you can really use the data to tell a story and show in visualizations and graph what you have discovered. So what is the data science process? So basically, the data science process is that, well, where do you start? Well, you start sort of in the world, right? And from the world, whatever world, part of the world you're studying, you collect raw data. And then you sort of process this data in some way, and you start exploring the data. This is the exploratory data analysis. So you process the data, you perhaps clean it up. If there are some errors, you try and correct those. If there's some missing data, you might try to insert estimated values and so on. And then you explore it, and then you go back. And you really do this a lot. So you look at the data, you try and clean it up, you try to take data from two different sources and merge them together to produce a unified data set, and you look at that again and so on, and you do this many, many times over. You also, and then once the data set is really solid, you can start building models. So you might build a prediction model. Perhaps if you have some data plotted, you can build a simple regression model or an advanced machine learning models. You might also produce some algorithms that do things with the data. And again, an iterative process, and you come out with some kind of data product, and you communicate and visualize the report, and you make decisions. And then the actual interesting thing is that once you release this data product, this knowledge, and you start making decisions and actions, you actually change the world. So then again, you can start, okay, so now we did something. How does it now work? Is it now any better? It's also iterations. So if we look a little bit more detail about data science overview and challenges, here's a reference to a Communications of the ACM paper, where they interviewed a lot of scientists sort of from biology and physics and so on about what they spent their time on. So, well, first that's the data preparation phase. So the first thing is just acquiring the data, getting hold of the data. Where do you get it from? Can you find it on the web? Can you download it or stream it? Or can you get it from some kind of device or whatever? Or do you actually type it in manually on the computer and so on? Just getting the data is often very difficult. And there's all kinds of problems here. So the provenance is where does the data come from? Can you trust it and so on? And then how do you manage the data? How do you store the data? So then the next phase of preparation is also very important. So this is about reformatting and cleansing the data. So you have to fix any errors. And again, you have to look at the data a lot to see if they really make sense. You have to integrate and transform it to a useful format so that you have a format that makes sense and you have some meaning. And this is actually the most time-consuming phase. And you have no insights yet. You're still just, you know, struggling with the data. Then you get to the analysis phase where you do some editing, you run perhaps some Python scripts or R scripts or whatever, and you sort of, okay, you get some kind of results, some kind of graph out of it, like we can see up here. You look at the outputs and then, oh, but that can't be true and so on. And then you try and find if there's an error and you edit and you go here over and over. this is really a trial and error phase. There's all kinds of long run times and crashes and so on. But finally, you probably get some good results. You get a nice graph. You actually know something. And then you need to reflect. So you also need to think here. So you need to think about what does this actually mean? And here you have to relate it back to the real world. And you also have to, so how does this fit with the theories we have? How does this fit with knowledge we have? And you also have to communicate. So what does this mean? What is our new insight here? And then you have to disseminate it. And of course, you can disseminate in many ways. You can write a report, but also increasingly, you can actually publish your data. There are ways of publishing your data sets and your analysis in a shareable and way so that you can actually share it with scientists all over the world. They can repeat your experiments, but they can also extend your experiments and so on. So this is very interesting. So is that actually something new? So it, you know, this thing with the data, is that actually something new here? Well, in some sense, it's not. You know, using data to get wiser is nothing new. People have, you know, that's statistics. And so we've been doing this for hundreds of years. But actually, you can do more than before with data, right? But let's rewind just a few decades here, back to the prior millennium, to some old foundational concepts. And what will we look at? Well, of course, artificial intelligence, AI, was sort of coined as a term in the 50s. But AI, well, what is AI? I found this really funny tweet here once. So this is a tech entrepreneur from Silicon Valley. And he says, repeat after me. So artificial intelligence, AI, is an application of ML machine learning. Then you probably heard a lot about, you know, neural networks and deep learning and so on. So deep learning, this is a technique in machine learning. So this is one specific machine learning technique. And 80% of the practice of machine learning is getting the right data. So when you have a machine learning project, you know, it takes this long, then this part here is just about getting the right data. So data management for the win. So really getting the data and getting them correct and integrate and so on. This is the important part of AI. Then the rest is the simplest part, okay? So what we'll focus on here is two old concepts called a data warehouse and business intelligence. So let's look at those. So when you do analysis, what are the typical problems you run into? Well, actually, so this we did some 20 years ago. We worked with a sort of a financial company, a mortgage provider, and when we started working with them, we saw that the same data was found in many different systems. So, for example, when we started collaborating with them, they had customer data in 14 different systems. 14, that's a lot. But actually, a few years later, when we talked to them again, now suddenly it was 23 different systems. So you had customer data sort of all over the place, and they were not consistent and so on. So this was a big problem. And more importantly, the same concept could also be defined differently. So at, here at Nykredit, actually, they had, first they were just a mortgage provider, but then they got a bank and they got also an insurance company. So now they are sort of a financial supermarket. And it turned out that the, you know, just agreeing between those three branches of the corporation about what is actually a customer, they couldn't agree, you know. So in the bank, usually this was sort of very focused on the person. In the mortgage institution, you sort of focused a lot on the property, the house, because that was the security. And in insurance, this was more about perhaps the household or something. So they couldn't even, so they had to spend years actually modeling what is a customer just for this one small Danish company. Another problem is that the data is often suited for operational systems, what is called OLCP. So there's a system for accounting, there's a system for billing and so on. But these systems don't support analysis across functions. Also, data quality is bad. We have missing data, you have imprecise data, you have different use of systems. And also in these operational systems, data are volatile. So data is deleted in the operational systems when you don't need them anymore, perhaps after 6 months, after people paid their bills and so on. But what if you want to do analysis over 10 or 20 years? Then you need it. and also data changes over time. So in the billing system, you just need the current address of the customer. But if you want to analyze your customers over 20 years, you need their address at all times, also in history. And now on top of this, we have GDPR, the EU Privacy Directive, which means that you also have to be very careful about what kind of personal sensitive data you store and how you do it. So these are problems. So how was this solved? Okay, so here we go back perhaps 25 years to the mid 90s, you make what's called a data warehouse. So this is a new analysis environment where you do something different about data. So you orient data by subject instead of by function. You integrate it logically and physically. You have stable data. So you don't delete data, and you can have as many versions as you want. You can have all, if the customer lived in five places, you can have five versions of the customer with the different addresses. And you can always refer data to when was it valid in time. And you have now designed this data warehouse to support management decisions, which is quite different from the operational systems. And to do this, you take data from the operational systems and you extract them, you cleanse them, you transform them. So you, out of the source systems, you clean up the data, and then you sort of make it into a new format. So if the data looked like this before, perhaps it now needs to go together and look like this. And then you might aggregate a bit, perhaps you don't need all the detailed data, and then you put it into the data warehouse. This is sort of what's called getting the multidimensional into the data warehouse. And a good data warehouse is a prerequisite for successful BI. So a data warehouse, the purpose of a data warehouse is to support decision-making. Again, you collect data from many sources, from finance, from billing, from web logs, from personnel, and you make it easy to perform advanced analysis. Ad hoc analysis, reports, and so on. You can use data mining algorithms to find trends and patterns, and you can use specialized management information systems. So a data warehouse is a store of information organized in a unified data model. So let's look at some figures here. So basically you can think of a data warehouse architecture as sort of a number of materialized data sets or views. So here on the left-hand side, we have a lot of source applications, you know, financing, accounting, and so on, and a lot of source databases. So these are the existing databases and systems that we call online transaction processing, OLTP. Then on the right-hand side, we have the new databases and systems, which we call online analytical processing, OLAP. And basically what we do is that in the middle, we have the global data warehouse, which sort of contains all the data from our enterprise, but aimed at decision support, not operational purposes. So what we do is that we extract data from the sources here, we run it through a transformation, we load it into the data warehouse. But the data warehouse itself has really a lot of data. This is probably too much for most people. So then you actually often make sort of subsets, so specific subsets of the data warehouse, which you call data marts, which are used by, for example, by the sales department or the economics department, so on. And then they can be used. So this is a way of reducing complexity for end users. So if we look at the differences here, OLTP and OLAP, so the operational OLTP systems, they have many small queries on data. You insert a new customer, you update the customer, you say, okay, now they paid their bill and so on. And you have very frequent updates of the data. And the system is always available for both updating data and reading data. However, each of the queries only touch very little data. And you don't have all the historical data, all the old customer addresses and so on are gone. And the data model here is quite complex. It's what's called normalized. So data is spread out in many different tables to make it easy to update. In online analytical process, you have fewer queries, but they're much bigger. They touch much more data. You read the data a lot, but you might not update it that frequently, depending on what you need. So often you have sort of a two-phase operation, either read or update, and you have much, much larger volumes of data because you have all the historical data. And the data model here is quite simple. It's what's called multidimensional or denormalized, as we'll see later. So it's easier to understand for ordinary users and see how data is connected. The key take-home message here is that data is a great thing because you can have as many copies as you want. So you can sort of duplicate the data. You don't if you have a new purpose. So really taking the data is fine in operational systems, but duplicating them for a new analytical purpose is often a good thing to do. So again, if we look at this function or subject orientation, here we have the function oriented systems, and here we have the subject oriented systems. And then in the data mart, you have selected subjects. And in the warehouse, you have all subjects that are integrated. So actually, these are sort of cross-cutting. So if you say this green one could be about the customer, this could be about finance, this could be about things from web, this could be about our sales efforts and so on. Then the point is that the green topics, they have everything about this from all the systems, whereas each of the operational systems, they have only a little part. They have only, perhaps the CIM system knows only about the customer address and demographics and so on, but it doesn't know about all the customer orders and all the customer bills and so on. So these are sort of orthogonal ways of looking at the data. So how do we build it? You know, could we go directly to the data marts? Well, we could, but then, you know, this is not so good, right? Because now we actually have to do this whole transformation thing for every data mart. So we have to connect from this data mart to all the systems out here, do all the complex stuff and load in. Then again, from this data mart, we have to repeat all of that and do it here. And again, from this data mart, we have to do all the complex things again and again. So this is actually not a good idea. Whereas if we use the data warehouse, only where we only had one joint transformation process, we would have need to build fewer connections to the existing systems. Well, we could also, well, perhaps we have sort of the data warehouse here where we have most of it goes into the big data warehouse, but then we have this data mart on the side. But that's actually also a bad idea because then it's very likely that the data here and the definitions here are out of sync with the big data warehouse. And then we have sort of inconsistency in our data. So that's also not so good. But then what we can do is that we can somehow design the data warehouse. Of course, this is a very big process. So how do we start? Well, we can do it top down. So first we design the data warehouse and then we design the data marts. Okay, that's what we could also do it the other way around. We could sort of design the data marts first and then, you know, maybe integrate them into the warehouse, maybe not, and so on. And actually what turns out is that it's sort of best to do something a little bit in between. So you sort of first start by designing the data warehouse for the first data mart. Then you design the second data mart, but also then you make sure that the first and the second data mart are integrated, that they, you know, define things in the same way, that the numbers mean the same and so on. Then you add data mart 3, so now everything is consistent and so on. So it's sort of an iterative approach is the best. Okay, so multi-dimensional data. I told you that the data was organized in a different way, and let me show you what that is. So in multidimensional data, you have sort of this data cube metaphor that I showed you on an early slide. And the idea is that you divide the data into several kinds. So there are what's called facts. These are sort of the important events that you want to analyze. That could, for example, be sales of products. And then there are dimensions, which are sort of the aspects of the data. So for example, here we have some sales and we have time, we have the year, we have cities in Denmark, Aalborg and Copenhagen, we have products, we have bread. So there's three dimensions. And then at the intersection of these, we have cells and inside them we have numbers. So this could be, for example, how many units did we sell or how many thousand kroner did we sell for? And then also we have hierarchy. So basically the products can be categorized into product types and again into product categories. And this can be used to sort of look at data at the right level of detail. And then we can on this perform online analytical processing or OLAP, which is fast interactive analysis of large amounts of data. also you can think about it as spreadsheet on steroids. So in spreadsheet, you sort of have two dimensions. You have the rows and the columns, and then perhaps sometimes you have these sheets. So with a lot of work, you can go to three dimensions, but you can't go to 5 or 10 dimensions. This is what OLAP lets you do in a very easy and scalable way. And then basically, when you have such a cube, you can do two types of queries. You can sort of either navigate or explore the dimensions, you know, which products are in this type and so on, or you can aggregate and disaggregate along the dimensions, roll up or drill down. So for example, if we sort of, okay, this is our first result, you know, we can see that in Aalborg, sales from 2000 to 2001 are a bit flat, but in Copenhagen, they go up. So why is that? Then actually we can see, okay, let's just get an overview. So we roll up, we actually aggregate over all time, and then we can just see the total sales from Aalborg and Copenhagen. But then we could also see, okay, why is it actually that it goes up in Copenhagen, but not in Aalborg? Then we can do a drill down. So we can basically go into the Aalborg 2001, this one, and sort of explode it out and perhaps go down to the individual quarters, to the individual neighborhoods or stores in Aalborg, and really understand what is causing the problem here. Why do we have growth in Copenhagen and not in Aalborg? And this kind of analysis is the foundation for business intelligence and analytics. So what is business intelligence then? So business intelligence is the ability to apprehend the interrelationship of presented ways in such a way as to guide action towards a desired goal. A bit abstract, but also this was early days. So this term was proposed by IBM in 1958. So that's quite a long time ago. It's not a new thing. Then also it's been updated over the years. Here's a more recent one from Gartner 2013. Business intelligence is an umbrella term that includes the applications, infrastructures, and tools and best practices that enable access to an analysis of information to improve and optimize decisions and performance. So this is about optimizing your business using data. So that could be, for example, how is the sales, the total sales by product category, but also what is the trend over time? You can drill down by a month and sort of see how does it go up and down. And also how do the sales correlate with the location? So you can sort of drill down on the store location. Okay. So big data, of course, what we heard about so far was that small data. It was certainly not big data. So what is big data? Another term that we heard a lot in the recent years. And so Wikipedia defines it in this interesting way. So big data is the term for a collection of data sets so large and complex that it becomes difficult to process using on-hand database management tools or traditional data processing applications. And this is sort of, in some sense it's abstract, but it's also a very specific definition because it says that to be big, it has to be so big that it is difficult to do what we used to do. So we have to do things differently. And big data, you often talk about the four V's of there's actually more V's, but these are the main ones. And you don't have to have all of them. One or two is enough. Okay, so the first V is volume. So we have very large data volumes, really a lot of data. Velocity, so this is about the speed of data arrival. Data arrives really, really fast in streaming data. Perhaps you get many, many updates per second and so on. Then you have the third B, variety. So data has varied and complex formats and types and meanings and so on. This is where the domain knowledge comes in, right? And then the fourth one is veracity, which is really about how good is the data? How much can we trust it? There are more V's, there's viability, you know, can the data be used for anything useful? Visibility, not to you as a person, but to the big data processes, can you get hold of the data? Variability, which means that the meaning of data changes over time. For example, the use of hashtags in tweets changes from year to year, so they don't mean the same the year after as they did the year before. And you have to take account for that into account. And then visualization, you need to do to understand, and value. Does this data really add value for you to use? So if we look at business intelligence, which is sort of the old traditional concept, and big data and data sciences, Then there are some similarities, you know, what is not so new. So this whole thing about collecting and integrating and analyzing data, even if there's lots of it and it's fast, that's actually not so new, right? But there are some differences. So this is actually what's really new about big data and data science. And let's look at that. So you have first about the types of data. So for business intelligence, this was mostly structured data, you know, data from tables, spreadsheet-like data with sort of categories and numbers and so on. Whereas with big data, you also have unstructured data. You have text, you have video, you have social media data, you have, you know, all kinds of unstructured things. And where did you get the data from? Well, in the good old days in business intelligence, this was sort of a sort of organization, a company internal thing. So these are mostly internal sources from all these operational systems that you had. Whereas in the new world of big data and data science, these are mostly external. So you get data from perhaps tweets about you and your organization or your topic. This is external data that comes from an outside source, but it's very important. And where do you deploy the systems? In the good old days, you had a server in the basement and you deployed it on that. So this was in-house. These days, most of this is deployed in the clouds, so on an external system. In BI, the history, you know, where did the customer live at certain time? And so this was really essential. Whereas in big data and data science, it sometimes becomes less relevant because again, with this variability, the meaning is changing over time anyway. So perhaps having this really big fancy history doesn't make sense. Also, who are the users here? So in BI, the typical user is a manager or controller, sort of, you know, boring people with ties and so on. Whereas in the user here for big data data science is the data scientist that we just heard about. So a new type of user. Also, this relates to what kind of precision do you need in the results? And in BI, it was super important that when you had a number like the revenue or something, it was really correct with two digits and after the decimal point and so on. Otherwise, you wouldn't trust it. Whereas in big data, well, you don't have all the data anyway. It's from external sources and so on. So approximate results might be fine. Also, privacy. Before you, this was all company internal data, so privacy was not that important. Whereas now, in the new times, this is critical due to GDPR and others. Also, interestingly, in the old days, you had almost full control of the data. Most of the source systems were your own internal operational systems running in your basement. Now you have little or no control of the data. You have all this external data that comes from places you can't control. And what kind of analysis did you use? Well, reports and OLAP, and now increasingly we'll learn models, we do predictions and so on, as we'll see. And also the starting point is very different. BI was sort of a top-down process where you started with the system and built a business intelligence analysis solution. Whereas in data science, you sort of start bottom-up. You take the data sets and integrate them, right? And the software was usually closed source and licensed software, whereas in big data and data science, you have a lot of open source tools. So it's really, there's a lot of different things here. And let's look at what this is. So in the good old days, we were sort of, you know, sucking data on a straw like this little girl, I guess it is here. So we put data into the data warehouse, you know, we pulled out some reports and so on. This is all nice. So we could sort of control how much data we got at which times. Whereas here, we sort of get data sprayed in our face. You know, we get a lot of data coming in. We have to handle it live and streaming and so on. So this is an illustration of the difference here. So what are typical types of big data? Well, first of all, there's search data. So this was the first type of big data, like Google's data. So, you know, web searches and rankings and so on. But now, and that's, you know, that's for Google and a few other companies. However, a data source which is very relevant for many is social network data. So all the updates from Twitter and Facebook and LinkedIn and internal user fora and so on, with the text and images and so on, and likes and friends graph and so on. This is so interesting. For example, if you're in digital humanities or computational social science, this is a super important data source that you can actually use to learn new things about human behavior and how people act in groups and so on. Also, then you have linked data and open data, where you publish data on the web, for example, using semantic web technologies. But it's not just web. There's also big sensor data. So like, for example, from the CERN, Large Hadron Collider, there's GPS location data, RFID, and energy data that we'll look at later. So big data, is that a technical problem? Yes, it is, but that's not what I'm going to talk about today. Of course, we need to handle these really big data volumes, and the data arrives very fast, and they have all these different formats and meaning and so on. And well, that actually meant that at least in the first wave of big data, you couldn't use sort of relational SQL database technologies because they were limited to single servers. They couldn't scale. And also, if you sort of first stored the data and then process it, you couldn't sort of ingest it fast enough. And it didn't really fit into all these tables and so on. So what we've seen a lot in the big data space is a lot of specialized systems. So this is yet another Turing Award winner, Michael Stonebreaker from MIT, that wrote this paper about 15 years ago about one size fits all, which was the good old relational database management system like SQL Server, Oracle, and so on. And that was an idea whose time has come and gone. So since then, we've seen really a lot of different systems for handling different kinds of data. And I could talk about that for many, many hours. But since you are a broad audience, I will not go into that arena, but some other day in a more specialized setting. Okay, so instead I want to get back to data science, sort of again, talk a little bit more about data science. What is it and how do you do it? So the problem, what do you want to do? Well, actually the problem, the business problem might be very simple. So you want to predict the demand for cupcakes for the next 2 weeks. So say you have your own little cupcake shop, and you want to predict that. But what is it that you actually want to do? So you want to learn the internals of, you know, machine learning algorithms, and you have to do some data sampling and feature selection and cross-validation. You perhaps have to learn Spark and Hadoop, implement some algorithms, find the right parameters, implement validation and experiment. And so there's all these technical kind of things you have to do something which is actually very simple, right? And again, the first thing you have to do is, as we talked about before, is sort of wrangle with the data and really try and fit it in, right? So you sort of want to get from raw data to usable data and findings, right? This is what we want to do. But usually it's not like that. It's actually more like this, right? So you have the original data sets. You sort of first you want to look at them, see, you know, do they make sense, and so on. This is what's called diagnose here, and then you try and do something about it, you know, you transform them, and then finally we have something that we can get into the analysis application like R and so on. But then you discover, oh, there's a big problem here, and then actually you end going all the way back to the process that you're trying to analyze and perhaps getting some new data and so on. And again, so back and forth, you start the analysis and so on. And then finally, you might come out here where you actually get a result. And you might update the data sets and do the whole thing again with new data and end up with the usable finding. So this whole process here is called data wrangling. And this is where 80% of the time goes. This is what you have to expect. So once you got from that, you need to learn models from data. And what is that? That's a further step from simple BI. So models are like mathematical abstractions over data. And that could, for example, be something very simple. If we have this data here, you know, these are temperature, and then this is how much frozen yogurt is sold. Okay, and you can sort of see some kind of trend here. And actually what we could do is we could just fit a line. This is called linear regression, which actually is not a bad model. So certainly if it gets warmer, we sell more frozen yogurt, but of course we can't quite explain all these outliers here. But so that's a very simple one, but we could also have more complex ones, deep learning, neural networks, Bayesian models, and so on. So models is something that can generalize over unknown data. So even you know, if we had out here at 110 degrees, we don't have data for that, but we could actually predict that we will sell even more frozen yogurt. So it's very important that we can generalize over unknown data. And the way we learn this is through parameter fitting. So this is about sort of, you know, adjusting the line until they're sort of the shortest average distance to all these points. So machine learning, basically there are two kinds of things. So there's supervised learning and unsupervised learning. So in supervised learning, you basically give some examples and you have labeled them. So you have said these are the good, this is class one, this is class two, and then the algorithm will learn the classes. So for example, if you have said, you know, these are the circle ones, these are the cross ones, then the algorithm in supervised learning will sort of, okay, how does the boundary look like? So if I get a point here, that is probably a red cross, and if I get a point here, that's probably a blue circle. So this is what supervised learning do. Whereas unsupervised learning is different. So here you just provide the data and let the algorithms find meaning in it. So for example, if you do clustering, actually you can get this, and then the algorithm will spit out, okay, it looks like there's a cluster here, a cluster here, and a cluster here. So think about data in these three categories. Okay, but how do you get around to doing that? So I'm perhaps repeating myself a little bit, but sort of from different angles, because again, it's really the process is really, really important here. And here I'm talking about a different methodology called the BI journey from Danish BI vendor Target, which really understand how do you, you know, when you do all this business intelligence and analytics and so on, what is the journey here? And the important thing is this is a multi-step process. And it's sort of here we have a classical top-down process where you sort of crawl before walking, you do the simple things first, and you spend a lot of time to build foundations. But you could also slice it in a little bit different way, sort of more bottom-up data science-like, where you slice and mix these phases and get some advanced results early. But basically, there are three phases. First of all, to really understand what's the health of the business, what's the state. Then you have to achieve sort of what's called operational excellence. And finally, you go strategical instead. So let's look at those three phases. So in stage one, this is a short paper called The Three Stages of Becoming a Data-Driven Organization. Target really talks about phase one, basic BI and analytics. So here you do things like advanced reporting, you get some query-based analysis, some dashboard and some storyboards, and the ones doing it is used like IT, finance and sales, and the users here are finance and functional managers and use this sort of dedicated BI and analytics tools. And again, what you can do here is sort of tactical decision-making. So you have some key performance indicators, KPIs, and you can get some numbers out and act on those. And what you get are sort of pre-built cubes with internal data. So this is all good. Then you understand, okay, how's the money thing and so on. If you're a university, perhaps you can understand how is it with the students, you know, how long do they take to graduate and find some problems and so on. Then from there you go to stage two, which is real-time data discovery and actions. So here you want to sort of go deeper into the data. You want to discover things, you want to do predictive analytics, so build models that can predict the future, do more modeling of data, do real-time analytics and visualize things. And what you get here is new knowledge. So you have these multidimensional knowledge, you get more individualized dashboards and alarms and so on, and you can also get warnings on mobile platforms and so on. And here it's sort of further out in organizations with the individual users, and they can be at the higher sort of management level, but also now in sales and marketing and supply chain, sort of spread this out in the organization. We use data discovery tools, mobility, and project dashboards. And you have proactive decisions based on analytical findings that lead to strategical improvements and so on. And now you also include external and unstructured data sources. That's very important. So this could be things like social media, web, and so on. Then you get to stage three, which is about competitive analytics. So here you also do data mining and experimentation, and now you're focusing more on getting sort of insight, but also foresight into what will happen. So these are now business analysts and users, and you really, now you work with much bigger data volumes, but you can also do things at the more strategic levels. So here you have to have very large quantities of both structured and unstructured and external data. And the goal of all this is to improve the so-called OOAD loops in your organization. So basically an organization is an OOAD loop. And if you can sort of do these cycles faster, you become more competitive. And that actually holds for all organizations. So first, the first phase in O is observation. And here you look at the data and you have an expectation. So you sort of understand, you have some idea about what you'll see, and you have an expectation, and then you can see if it fits, right? So these are reports and dashboards, and maybe also these agents, right? So this is this, and then okay, you looked at the data, then you have okay, so you might see something, you know, that is what you expect, something that's not. Then you have to orientate. You have to sort of, you know, what happens if I do this and that? So you see data depending on results. So you know, you want to see the unexpected. You do analysis, you mining, you have to do some simulation here. Then you have to make a decision. So now you know some, and actually derive some knowledge, and mostly with human intelligence, but also being automated, you make a decision, and then you have to take action. So then you implement that decision in the organization, and you have made a change. And then, of course, now the world has changed, so then you can go again, right? And then you cycle this one through here, and the faster you can cycle it, the more competitive you are. However, of course, we talked a lot about process here, but of course, a good process is not enough. If we look at Dilbert here, so basically, the pointy-haired boss says that he should use that database to size the market, but that's wrong. Then use the other SIPS database, but that's also wrong. Can you average them? Sure, and I can multiply them too. The point is, it makes no sense. If you have bad data, you can't do anything. So good data is really key here. However, if you have good data and enough of it, that really beats everything. And here's some insights from this paper from Alan Harlevy and Peter Norvig and so on from Google, the unreasonable effectiveness of data, which was published in IEEE Intelligent Systems. And they talk a lot about sort of experiences from Google, especially in things like machine translation and so on. And what they say is that data is actually more important than models. So if you have simple models and lots of data, that's better than really complex and elaborate models with less data. So for example, in machine translation, if you have all these sort of parallel texts that are translated, this is much better than all these, you know, computational linguistics rules and patterns and so on, because here we have a huge shared cognitive and cultural context. Because of this, the linguistic expression is very ambiguous, and it's hard to make rules. So of course, what modeling is not enough. We always need interpretation. And just putting some formalism on top, like semantic web, still requires interpretation afterwards. But choosing the right representation is very important. And again, you really need to get data, and making labels is often very costly because it will often require human intervention. So they say you should choose a representation where you can use unsupervised learning on labeled data, because that's so much more plentiful than labeled data. Okay, then we heard about the data warehouse, there's also a new term here, the data lake. And what is a data lake? So it's like a lake, a water lake, where you sort of pump things in, but now it's data. You put in structured data, so BI kind data, but also unstructured, so emails, PDF, video, audio, social media, and so on. And then you put it all in, and then instead of sort of pre-integrating and making everything nice as you did in the data warehouse, in the data lake, you just sort of dump it in and then you make sense of it afterwards. So it's more of an iterative and bottom-up approach, where the data warehouse was a top-down, more design-driven approach. And then you sort of sift through the data to sort of catch with your net the data that you need. And if we then look again at the data warehouse and the data lake, in the data warehouse, we have a structured and processed data, whereas in the data lake, we also have semi-structured and unstructured and raw data. So in the data warehouse, we have defined the schemas and so on, whereas in the data lake, data can have any format. So instead, we sort of read the data and then figure out what the schema is when we read it. Data warehouse technology is very good technology, but it's also quite expensive if you have a lot of data, whereas data lakes is designed for low-cost storage, so you can really put in a lot without being too expensive. And it's highly agile. You can configure and reconfigure as needed. Whereas the data warehouse, you really try to make a model of things that was consistent, so it's less agile. Security is often more mature here. It's getting better here. And this is for business professionals, whereas this is for data scientists. Is it either or? Of course not. But what many people do these days is that they sort of start with a data lake and then gradually refine it so that parts of it becomes more like a data warehouse. Again, it's good to sort of start small and work your way up. So actually it's not either or, it's both and. What about the cloud then? We also hear a lot about cloud analytics. Is that something new? Well, famously, Larry Ellison of Google said, of Oracle, of course, said, there is no cloud, it's just someone else's computer. And that's true. But then again, cloud computing has changed analytics a lot. And the interesting thing is Larry Ellison changed his mind, because what Oracle sells now is not licenses, but cloud services. Also, the pricing model have changed. In the old days, you had to buy a lot. You had to buy hardware, servers. You had to buy a lot of licenses and so on. You had to have people and technicians and housing and network and so on. Whereas in the cloud, it's pay as you go. So you don't have an upfront investment. You can scale up when you need, and then you pay for that. So you basically pay as for what you use instead of having all this upfront. So you can start small and scale on demand. And that's actually really, really important because it makes it much more democratic and widely available for many people. Also, the performance metric have changed. Before, it was always as fast as possible, focus on bigger iron and efficiency, but now it's more like performance per dollar and sort of good enough performance. And there's really a lot of cloud analytics. Of course, there's, infrastructure as a service like S3 and Amazon computing instances, but also higher level platform like Spark as a service and so on hosted clouds, still a bit low level, but if you have a self-deployed solution, you can deploy it, but also you can have data warehouse, data lake house as a service. So like Microsoft Azure, Amazon Redshift, Databricks, and so on. This is even more high level. You have your entire data warehouse with data, queries, and reporting, all as a house, as a hosted cloud service. But you can also have models as a service. So Azure and Google and so on, they provide pre-trained models, and you can build your own, and even domain analytics as a service, for example, the in medical, in legal, and so on, like the ROS AI legal aid. So what can this be used for? Well, we can actually do a lot of exciting things here, because we can know, what and how everything was. This is like historical analytics. So how was the energy production? How was the solar energy consumption? How was the solar production? What value did the sensor have? we can also know, so this was historical analytics, but we can also know how everything is now. So real-time analytics, what is the sensor now? All kinds of sensor, DPS and power and so on. But also we can do predictive analytics, so we can know what and where everything will be in a short while. Predictive analytics. What is the power consumption? What are the CO2 emissions in 6 hours? Where are the traffic jams in 30 minutes? But even then, we can also know what to do about it, which is called prescriptive analytics. So how can we act today to best optimize for tomorrow? How should power consumption be controlled to match PV and wind? And how can users optimally interact with this, like recommendations? And now I get to a bit of my own story. I'm sorry, I have to pause the recording now because I have to get some more water. So just a minute. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about my own sort of data science story related to the Sustainable Development Goals. I call it SDG 7 and 13, the first 14 and a half years, which is how long I've been working with these SDGs. They were not called that at that time, but this is data science analytics for smart and digital energy. These are SDG 7, affordable and green clean energy, and SDG 13, climate action. So what is the motivation for this? Well, of course, we want to transition away from fossil energy, get better energy security and so on. And a good way forward is renewables. So the good thing about renewable energy is that it's clean, but it's actually also very cheap. In many places of the world, new wind turbines is the cheapest way to produce new electricity. In other places, it's solar PV panels. But the sort of the challenging thing about renewables is that they're fluctuating. So you sort of, you know, either you have too little or too much energy. So this is a figure here from the Danish transmission system operator in Kinet DK. And they say in 2008, when we have 20% wind power, we sort of, you know, this the red here is the demand and the blue is the wind production. Okay, so then in later in 2025, when we have 50% wind power, some days there will be more wind power than what we actually need. So we'll have too much electricity. So what should we do about that? And what was interesting was that things actually happened much, much faster than they thought. So they made the figure in 2008 and thought that the problem would come in 2025, but it actually came already in 2013. You started having these peaks where there's more wind power than needed. So what can we do about that? Well, luckily we can be flexible about when we use our electricity. So simple things in a household like a dishwasher, you know, we could run them when there's a lot of wind power or solar power available. We can charge or decharge our EVs flexibly so that we use the power when it's there and not otherwise. If we have a heat pump for heating our house, we can control it so it fits better with the wind production and so on. And the future electricity demand is actually, this is actually very interesting. So in Denmark, the electricity demand, not the energy demand, but the electricity demand is expected to triple. And this is because things like EVs and heat pumps and so on. So a lot of the energy that was before fossil now becomes electric. So the demand for electricity goes up, but of course the fossil part goes away. And luckily about 80 to 85% of future demand is flexible. There's a big potential. This is not just domestic. This is also industry, sector coupling and so on. So what you often see is that if you can convert from one type of energy like electricity to another like heat, you can have so much more flexibility in how you balance this. So this is sort of the motivation here. So, and for example, here, there's a story from The Guardian about how wind power already a couple of years ago generates 140% of Denmark's electricity demand. Luckily, then we can sell it to other countries. Anyway, so digital energy and data science, what is that? What is the big picture here? Well, we have a lot of sensor data here, you know, from production, from consumption and so on. But also these, we have a lot of time series that need to be forecasted. So one thing which is very interesting in this sector here is that you sort of forecast everything even several times and try to optimize into the future. And you need to collect and manage flexibilities about, okay, so when, you know, what kind of energy do I need, and how can I move it around in time or turn it up and down? I need to predict production and consumption and flexibility, not just at the high level, but actually down to the device level so that we can really optimize. And then I need to balance consumption, production, storage in real time. And typically what we optimize for is not to spend less energy, but to spend it when it's low on CO2 or it's cheap. So we try to optimize this, minimize the CO2 emissions or minimize the cost, not the amount of energy. And this is then a complex process that we have been working with a lot. And the end goal here is, like I said, prescriptive analytics. So in analytics, there are three stages. So the simple one is descriptive analytics, which is sort of looking back to what happened. Then predictive analytics that we already talked about is sort of trying to predict the future, what will happen. But then prescriptive analytics is about foresight. So how can we make it happen? And of course, this is the more difficult one. So let's look at an example from digital energy. So if we need to balance this demand and supply, then let's say that this is the, you know, here we have the production from renewables, it's going like this. And then we have some non-flexible demand like this. And then the green part is sort of the demand that we can move around. And then what we want to do is that we want to sort of move around the green part so it fits as best possible with this line. Of course, the production from the renewables, we can't change that. The wind is there when it's blowing and so on. But we want to make sure that this fits the best possible, because usually the residual, we have to revert to gas turbines or the fossil sources to fill that out. So first we need to forecast the renewables production here. And of course, this is a time series like this. This is how much wind we get. And then we need to model what is the flexibility in the demand. And here we have developed a methodology called flex offers that I'll talk a little bit more about. And here, so basically what we can see is that in this time slot, we need at least the gray part, but then the green part is sort of, you know, this is the minimum energy, and then the green is the maximum. So we can somehow, inside these green parts, we can turn up or down, right? And then we need to schedule so that this fits best with this. And actually that happens when we follow exactly the red schedule here. And of course, this looks very simple, and it is, because the real problem has, we have many more things to balance, and also we have time flexibility and so on. But this is like the process we're trying to do. So we're trying to solve this puzzle here and move around things that we can control get a certain goal. So how did I get into all this digital energy? Was it really, you know, deliberate long-term planning, or was it more like chance? And of course, this was somewhere in between. So I, in my career, I always worked a lot with applications. So I did my PhD as an industrial PhD in so-called clinical data warehousing at a healthcare informatics company, Kommunedata. And then I worked with web applications and location-based services and music and agriculture and logistics and so on. And then someday, 15 years ago, my mentor said to me, you know, there's a lot of money in this energy field, and it seems like easy to get grants here. So why don't you look into that? And, you know, okay, I like to do what I'm told. So I did that. Okay, so then when you work with things like this, there's really two kinds of research, right? And okay, so here for a computer scientist like me, you can say there's sort of domain-oriented data management research. So this is about, you know, you develop concepts, so algorithms, which are like methods and computer systems that are specifically for smarter digital energy. And here, for example, we developed this thing, FlexOffers, which is a model where we can sort of model and extract and aggregate and disaggregate flexibility. But also, actually, they inspire for some general data management research. So actually, we can also develop general purpose concepts and algorithms and systems that that are not just for smart energy, but or digital energy, but inspired by that. And I also have an example of that. So ModelRDB is a storage, a big data system where we do model-based storage and querying of really big sensor data streams. And this is motivated by work we did with wind turbine data. So let's look at some of these models and here and so on. So Flex offers, this is about modeling flexibility. So for example, let's see, okay, we would like to model charging an electric vehicle. And let's say we get home at 5 o'clock and we leave at 7 o'clock in the morning. So this is what we see here. So basically we get home and we have a power profile. So in the first hour, we need to charge at least this much, but then we can basically turn up or down the energy. So from 0 to 2 kilowatts, so we have some energy flexibility and then like this. But then we can also take the whole profile and sort of we can start charging at 5 p.m. or we can start charging at 2 a.m. at night if there's more wind power there. So, and then we basically have a model where we can capture all these things, you know, and when do we need to start to sort of tell these things and a protocol for this, and we could perhaps even also, you know, extend the duration shorter later. And this is what the Flex offers is all about. So what we get here is a data model. And this the requirements for such a model is that it should be explicit, because we need to be explicit about what flexibility we have. This can capture more flexibility than implicit models. It should be general. It should capture sort of perhaps not all, but most loads, like also complex ones like energy conversion and heat pumps and so on. So we need to model state dependencies, energy production and storage and so on. And also it should be, what we really need to do is that we need to take many small loads, like all the small EV charging and so on, and then put them into really big ones, aggregate them into big units that we can trade in energy markets. So we need to aggregate from kilowatt hours to megawatt hours and back to sort of solve this in the big energy system. And then it should be scalable. So we need to do this for thousands or even millions of loads, which requires to use what's called approximate models, where you don't capture everything accurately, but then you get the scalability. Then also we need to extract the flexibility. And here's a general process for sort of generating and evaluating Flex offers. So we have time series, we have context information, and then we need to extract the time flexibility. So how can we move this around, and also the amount flexibility, how can we turn up or down? And based on that, we generate Flex offers, and then we can evaluate it in different ways. For example, you know, how much cost can we save with this flexibility? And then this is the general process. Then we have specific processes for example, wet devices like dishwashers, washers, and so on. We need to forecast when are they turned on, how long is it till they're turned on again, how long is the duration, and so on, and then generate Flex offers from that. If it's an EV, we need to forecast when is it plugged in, how much battery is probably there when it's plugged in, how long does it need to charge, and so on, and then we can generate for that. We can do this for heat pumps and so on, the conversion and so on. And here, what the result is more like data science processes and machine learning models. So that's another kind of result of this work. Then there's an algorithm challenge, which is again, when we have all these small ones and we want to put them into big ones. So we want to take the kilowatt hours and make them to megawatt hours. And here we have three requirements. And the interesting thing is that they're actually conflicting. So we want to preserve flexibility, and we want to aggregate as much as possible. So take as many as possible small ones and put them into a few big ones. We want to do this fast and scalable way. But then when we put them together, actually, if two things can move independently and we sort of put them together, then suddenly they're locked and we lose something. So we have to sort of strive a good compromise here. And this is a three-step process. First, we sort of found out it's good to group the Flex offer that sort of start at the similar times and have similar durations and sizes. And then we sort of try and bin pack them into some groups. And then we basically take the groups and generate one flex self out of that. And the result of this kind of research is like algorithms, so detailed methods that can be implemented in a computer program. Then also, if we look at energy time series, there are some really big and fast ones. And the ones I'm going to tell you about are from wind turbines. So a wind turbine is a fantastic piece of machinery. And I don't just say that because several of the largest producers in the world are either Danish or have most R&D in Denmark. But it's a really big machine. It has 500 sensors inside it. You can derive 2,500 data streams and so on. And what is interesting about all this is that data sort of starts out in the future. So you sort of, well, you sort of forecast data, you forecast it again, and so on. Then you make it to the present, which is the actual sensor values, and into the past, where you use the data for reforecasting and so on. And an interesting observation here is that you have forecasted data and real data. The main difference of that is accuracy. Of course, if you have a predicted value, it's not entirely accurate, but they share many of the same. And then we thought of this, okay, well, if you use models to forecast, why don't you also use models to store the data, represent the data? So whether it's historical or future, this is all models. And you can put a sort of an error on that, and then you can adapt the data and so on. And actually what we saw is that with wind turbine data, we could really compress data so much with this idea. So for example, if we take this is some old results. So we took something which was about 39 gigabytes in CSV, so comma separated text format. If we put it into a relational DBMS like PostgreSQL, actually it grew to 61 gigabytes. Then we could put it into a commercial RDBMS in row store. It was only 27. If we put it into a column store where you sort of compress data by column, it got a little bit better. If we put it into a specialized time series DBMS like InfluxDB, it got a lot better. Also in the big data systems, Apache formats, Parquet, and so on, helped. But actually we could get it down even further. So we could sort of, with this thing, we could really compress the data so much. And as you see, we are sort of compressing it really a lot compared to the raw data. And we actually built a modified version of Apache Spark, SQL, and Cassandra that we called ModelRDB, where we sort of do this online multi-model compression, and we can sort of do a lot of optimizations and so on, and execute aggregate queries and so on. And this is sort of an interesting aspect of, as I told you, all of the, in the big data world, there's a lot of open source. So basically all the major systems are open source. You can download them, you can extend them and so on. And this allowed us to sort of take our idea with these models and sort of put that into a complete big data stack, and then modify only a few things and actually try out our idea and sort of really implement it so it can be used in a big scale. And this is the architecture here. I'll not get into that. But again, so here the results are sort of, we have some models, we have algorithms, we have open source code and so on. So this is another type of result that we get. Then, of course, we had to get some grants to do all this, and I'll not get into the detail here, but we have to write a lot of proposals to get some grants, and that's a lot of work, but then you can pay for some young people. However, what I think is interesting, also working on these SDGs, it's really a good platform for collaboration. So for example, locally, at our department, a grant called TotalFlex was really the first grant where the three research group or departments, distributed and embedded intelligence systems, human centered computing, and database programming web technology worked together on a specific joint goal. And then actually more projects followed on. So it created collaboration locally in the department. Also, it created national collaboration, for example, Flexible Energy Denmark projects. We have Aalborg University, Aarhus University, Technical University of Denmark, University of Southern Denmark, and industry working together. It creates European collaboration. So for example, the first EU project we had about this Mirabel more than 10 years ago, the core partners are still collaborating. Now we're also collaborating with IBM Research Ireland and so on. So it's a good way to collaborate regionally, but also now we have started collaborating with other continents, so Waterloo, Canada, Queensland, China, and so on. So it's really a good platform for collaboration. And well, of course, it resulted in things. Let's not get into the details here, some journal papers and conference papers and keynotes and so on. But what was interesting is that actually we were able to publish this in both sort of, we could publish in outlets that were sort of specific to energy, computer science and energy, like e-energy and smart grid comp, but we could also publish this research in top data management outlets. So working with an SDG doesn't prevent you from doing sort of good core research. Actually not, right? And also, you know, this led to open source tools, to spin outs were formed and so on. So a lot of things happened. And finally, the computer science community also got interested in this energy. And now there's actually a SIG, ACM SIG energy. Now it says 2018. This is when the Emerging Interest Group was founded. The actual SIG came in 2020. So and e-energy is the flagship conference. So after many years, this has sort of been recognized at the ACM computer science level. So if I look back at these 14 and a half years, so what are the lessons and reflections here? So if you get into an application area, it takes really a long time to get into it, to understand, you know, everything that's... I remember when we started working in energy, it took years before we sort of understood the big system and all the processes and so on. So pick an area and stick with it, right? And synergy is good, and a lot of synergy is very good. And I still work on some other topics, but it's actually becoming more and more related to energy. And if you're good at something, and you did it for a long time, more and more opportunities occur. You know, you get invited into new projects and so on. So after a while, things sort of start, the snowball starts rolling and so on. So this is the investment will pay off, but it will take a while. And I think that the SDGs can give you good research challenges, both for domain-oriented, but also for general purpose research, and doing both is sort of important, right? You can get mutual inspiration and feedback. And if you work with sustainability, I have to say you should practice what you preach. So don't send your papers to sort of second-tier conferences on other continents and fly, but only fly for the really big things that are really important and so on. So, conclusion and outlook. Well, the world is changing, but the good news here is that we can do something about it. So the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, I think they're a good point to start, to pick your area of impact. And also, I talked a little bit about the scientific paradigms, and then most of the talk was about data science. So data science is a new skill that all researchers will have to use. I talked about sort of the foundations, what you did before with business intelligence, big data. I talked about processes and tools. And then I looked at data science for digital energy, so my application area. However, what you need to do is to think about how can you relate your research area to data science, perhaps also to SDGs. And again, this is not just for science and engineering. Digital humanities, computational social science are emerging as sort of new options in these disciplines. And I think in already happening, and we in the future, we'll all become part-time data scientists, but only in our own domain, because domain knowledge is essential. Okay, so at the end of the slides here, I think you will get them also. There are some links, there are some references, many reference to other people's papers and to my own papers and so on that you can have a look at. So, and thanks to some other people for also borrowing some of their slides. So this is what I have had for you. So thanks a lot for inviting me to give this keynote, and now I will be happy to answer some of the questions you might have.
I was saying.
Disculpas por eso. Está diciendo muchas gracias por su intervención, profesor Petersen. Definitivamente es un tema, o pensaba que era un tema del futuro, pero después de escuchar su grabación, entendí que es algo que necesitamos empezar a entender y aplicar ahora. Tenemos tiempo para recibir una pregunta. Será todo. Yo estoy en vivo, estoy en un simposio acá en Copenhague, pero estoy con sonido, con aislamiento, sonido, y los escucho perfectamente. Esta es la pregunta, profesor. Los procesos de investigación en una universidad generan mucha información. Información sobre el cual se podría implementar técnicas de machine learning, aprendizaje de máquinas. ¿Tiene experiencia usando analytics y aprendizaje de máquinas en investigación? ¿Y nos podría recomendar una hoja de ruta en este respecto? La respuesta corta sería no. No es algo en el cual he trabajado específicamente. Mucha analítica se hace sobre la investigación, los desenlaces de la investigación. Lo he visto, tengo colegas que trabajan con eso. Para ser sincero, se descontrola un poco. Las personas les gustan cifras pequeñas, cifras sencillas que pueden comparar. Creo que es muy importante no olvidarnos de las calidades de la investigación que están haciendo un labor importante e intentando cuantificar eso en cifras, no lo puedo hacer. Es interesante tener inteligencia de negocios, BI, en la universidad para entender de dónde provienen los recursos, a dónde se están invirtiendo los recursos, estamos priorizando los recursos adecuadamente. Esto es bueno. Pero básicamente siempre obtenemos lo que medimos. Si medimos algo y queremos optimizarlo, si medimos varios artículos, vamos a conseguir artículos, pero no necesariamente son buenos o están optimizados. Las personas se enfocan en las tendencias, los temas más populares, pero no solamente son relevantes. Como usted dijo, profesor Pérez, todos somos científicos de datos de medio tiempo. Gracias por su intervención, por la grabación. Son las 9:50 hora Colombia y tenemos que empezar a las 10. Le vamos a dar esos 10 minutos al público para que tengan un descanso, se tomen un poco de café. Profesor Pearson dice muchas gracias. Si hay otras preguntas, me pueden escribir por correo y las podré responder. Hoy por la tarde o mañana. Los datos de dominio son muy interesantes. Pero hay que tener la pericia, hay que tener conocimiento del dominio para poder trabajar y analizar con los datos. Mucha suerte con su travesía como científicos de datos. Gracias, profesor Pearson.
Por participar en esta sesión y al profesor Pedersen, pues por sus enseñanzas. Los invitamos a seleccionar el simposio de su preferencia, entrar a la sala correspondiente. Acuérdense que deben entrar a la agenda del Congreso www.javeriana.edu.co/congreso. Les deseo a todos un muy buen día.